Let's get to the 14th Semiosis 101 episode on general Peircean semiotic theory for illustrators and designers. This week, in around 10 minutes, we will focus on the highest level of semiotic representation in semiosis, symbolic. The symbol in a Peircean context is not what you may understand symbol to mean. You will see when we discuss symbolic representation, its Peircean meaning differs from your previous understanding and application of the word symbolic. So it is important to begin today with an open mind, as words in different social cultural contexts have different definitions. And Peirce wrote his pragmatic semiotic theory in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. So to understand symbolic representation in semiosis, in order to understand how to apply it into visual communication design, you must first bracket out any other definitions for the next 10 minutes as we explore symbolic representation. It will be a theory-packed 10 minutes of semiosis, but using designer-centric terms. So stay tuned, subscribe, hit the bell, open your mind. Okay, welcome to this week's talk. Previous 2 weeks, we're focusing on iconicity and indexical. Now we're moving up to the last of that, and the highest, not just the last, but also the highest visual representation within semiotics of symbolic. We've talked before about symbolic, about putting your ideas about what this means to one side, and let's just focus in on symbolic from the point of view of Peirce. So, unlike iconic or indexical representation, symbolic representation demands neither resemblance to its concept. So that's what we're obviously designing from the brief. So it doesn't necessarily need resemblance to that concept, nor an existential connection or bond with it. The symbolic sign eludes individual will. Now, what do we mean by that? Okay, so this idea of the symbolic sign eludes individual will. Well, symbolic representation of the concept we need to visually communicate means that it is a general semiotic sign. Now, that is a bit of a straightaway a thing where something that is so high and powerful within the three levels of representation, semiotic representation of the concept, to say that by the time you get to the highest level, it's just general, but there is real importance behind that, okay, what we mean by general. Because where its interpretation by the target audience, our target audience, arises from a general social cultural agreement of meaning. What we mean by that is within society, within our culture, we accept that when we see certain things together visually, it means a bigger concept. So we play on that idea when it comes to branding, etc., or any other form of symbolic visual communication in illustration, graphic design, design in general, but especially we're talking about within branding, that what we have is at this highest level, if we craft this highest level well, we can definitely have people accept that when they see that, it means this now. And this connection from that is socially and culturally agreed amongst those people. Okay? To anybody else, it won't mean anything. But to this group of people, that context, it now means this. Okay? So let's move forward and let's explore what we mean a little bit further about symbolically and how to represent ideas. Okay, so we must distinguish, first of all, clearly between a depiction or image, as Peirce would say, and an emblem. An emblem is a mixed sign, partially iconic and partially symbolic. So I've just thrown that word in there, emblem. You know, it comes from Wollan's book on semiotics within film, within cinema. But emblem, it's emblematic. It suggests something else. So as a symbol level, let's just refer to that now in our context of visual communication as a logo. And look at this World Wildlife Fund foundation of this, you know, recognizable logo featuring a panda. What do we mean by the fact that We've got the image, the depiction, and the emblem. Well, when it's all put together in the logo, that's when it's emblematic. That's when it's symbolic, because it's no longer about the panda. It's about the bigger concept of, you know, preserving our, you know, our planet's wildlife in its natural habitats, so that, you know, we have a future for our generations that come after us. So there's a difference there between the iconicness of the elements that come together that forms the panda. And we can see that on the right-hand side. We have passed the individual iconicness of that panda shape to one place. Whereas when it's configured together into the logo, that now refers to the WWF. Okay, so it's partly iconic because the elements that come together grab our attention, but now it's pointing us to a panda. So we've already looked last week about indexicality, about the fact that we can make a jump from indexical to an existent panda, and we can see that now, and that's how this logo helps us see that when we see these shapes in this particular order, it suggests a panda, but we're now talking about it at a symbolic level. So it's not just a panda anymore. This is an emblem, a logo that speaks on behalf of all endangered species. So already that image has gone from iconic to indexical and from indexical to symbolic, because it's got an agreed meaning that when we see this, it means that. Okay? When we see that, it means this. So we're already moving up in power. So let's move forward. Again, a genuine symbol, and this is what Peirce says, a genuine symbol is a symbol that has general meaning. General in the sense that more than one person can agree that when they see this, it means that. You don't have to have a debate about it. That it's commonly agreed that when we see this, we think of Coca-Cola. But all it is just red and white and a curved shape. But it has general meaning now that refers to, you know, Coca-Cola and all its ranges. But all it is just iconic shapes. So again, we've got iconicness, just the shapes and the colour. That put together now suggests to us who are within a society and a culture that is aware of a product called Coca-Cola. Then we can then go Coca-Cola. Indexically, it points us to that particular brand of Coca-Cola. So when we now see this together, we know it's Coca-Cola, and that's the same image that was first of all iconic is now working at that symbolic level. So a symbol, once in being, spreads among the peoples. In use and in experience, its meaning grows. So just the same way as it went from iconic to indexical in a flick of the eye, and from indexical to symbolic, this is because we have agreed that this particular shape, these particular colours, means Coca-Cola. So that's where the general meaning comes in. So that's where the power of the visual representation jumps up to, where it is at that function at the highest level. If you don't know what Coca-Cola is, you will just see the red and the white and this shape. If you know that this shape, the same image just moves to indexical. And with a movement to indexical, as soon as you get Coca-Cola, then you realize that this is part of a bigger symbolic representation of Coca-Cola as a brand, as a drink, etc. The image has done nothing. It hasn't changed. It's just the target audience bringing more of their own experience into their interpretation to get the meaning from something that is just a couple of colours next to each other. So this is where, you know, our idea behind logos and other elements of visual communication at the highest functional level of trying to communicate the meaning of the concept that we need to visually communicate can work. But it only works at that higher level if our audience can interpret it and has enough knowledge to accept it as a general meaning of something else. So this is where branding and everything else that we do within design at the higher functional levels can't work without semiosis. Okay, you don't need to know it's semiosis, because you can interpret this in many different ways, or you can apply different theories to how this works, and that's perfectly fine. But this is obviously all in the context of semiosis. So what we have is essentially a way of explaining how something can go from just a couple of colors to a big branded experience of this is that. Okay, so let's just move one step further and just wrap up this week's talk. So what we have is a symbol is a sign which refers to the concept that it denotes by virtue of a law. Peirce calls it a law. By the time it gets to this highest level, it's set in place in the social cultural context that when we see this, it means that. There's never been a committee setting out and saying, right, this means that. But it's just by symbiosis. People just accept that when they see this, it means that. So usually an association of general ideas which operates to cause the symbol to be interpreted as referring to the concept that we started from. So this is where Peirce is really, really important to us as designers and illustrators, because despite his problematic terminology most of the time, his thinking really helps us explain to ourselves first and foremost the power of what we do as a career path, that we visually communicate, we craft visual language to actually communicate maybe to just one person at an iconic level, or an idea to existing things at the indexical level, or even on a more general basis to more and more people just through, you know, a simple shape which is iconic. But this shape, when you see it now, if you see it as Nike, then you can see that it's actually working at that higher symbolic level. Now, all you need to see is this swoosh, and straight away you're thinking Nike. If you didn't know what Nike was, you wouldn't get that connection. Okay, so let's move to the last part of today's talk. So, as I've said in the previous two videos, this is a new section going forward for the remainder of season one of the Semiosis 101 videos. In the first 11 videos, we were just setting in place all the knowledge about Peirce's semiosis as a theory to help visual communication designers and illustrators. Now, here's the take-home bits. This is how you can start to think of your practice more semiotically as you do it, as you create these things. So during your development, when trying to develop branding, a logo, a corporate identity, consider crafting the iconic hooks. And in designing a brand archetype, more so than a word type, consider how the emblematic symbolic nature of the visual language that you choose to grab the attention is built up from the iconic building blocks. So we can see there, Nike, it's a swoosh. Iconically, it's a swoosh. It's this sort of like shape, but through symbolic level of social cultural connections, it now means Nike. Nothing else, no other brand, it means Nike. And that is the iconic moving to the symbolic. Okay, so audiences learn to associate what they see with a perception of and a feeling toward what is being branded. And this agreed association is semiotically crafted by yourselves. So by just now being aware of the power that is in your hands and your heads, you can really start to focus your attention in the right places, semiotically speaking, to enhance how you visually communicate. So that's it for this week. Come back again next week when we'll have another talk. And that's it for now. So don't forget, subscribe, hit the like, hit the bell, and leave a comment as well if you want to. But that's it for this week. Okay, thank you. Bye-bye. So that is our 10 minutes of Peircean Semiosis 101 for this week. Well, that was an eye-opener. Symbolic representation in pragmatic semiotics has a specific context different from symbolism and other uses of the word symbol. It is crucial to remember on this Scouse-Scot Semiosis 101 channel that the words Peirce uses will have different meanings in other design contexts. This is an unfortunate problem that is not Charles Sanders Peirce's fault. Words are elastic and can mean something different in other design contexts. The semiotic power of symbolic representation in semiosis within visual communication design is that at this higher semiotic level, your audience is crucial in developing effective visual language, and semiosis helps you craft it. When I teach semiosis at university to design students, the biggest confusion I see in the students stress whether a sign is iconic or symbolic. In their young designer's eyes, they are very similar in appearance. What is difficult to grasp at first is that the basic iconic building blocks are clearly present within symbolic representation. After all, the resemblance to qualities already known is the beginning of the act of semiosis. Now, these iconic elements are nested inside symbolic visual communication. The symbolic level of representation of the concept creates general semiotic signs. Symbolic meaning is general and agreed by the audience themselves, who have to learn it through socialization within a culture. What I mean by this is that a grouping of iconic colors, lines, and shapes in a particular formation can symbolically come together to mean a concept. Just think of any brand's logo. Iconic elements configured into a design that stands within a social cultural context for a company, a service, a product, an idea, etc. The secret here lies with the audience's interpretation. If only resemblance to something already known is recognized, a piece of visual communication will only semiotically communicate at an iconic level. If the same piece of visual communication is recognized as pointing to an existent thing, then the audience will make a more advanced interpretation of the concept at an indexical level. If the very same piece of visual communication is generally agreed to mean something within a social cultural context, then it operates at the highest semiotic level. If at the iconic level the audience makes no connection to anything known, then the same piece of visual communication won't perform semiotically at all. Therefore, within Peirce's semiosis, the visual communicator and the intended audience are entwined within a sign-action determination flow. In next week's video, we will expand on iconic, indexical, and symbolic representation and how audiences are existentially linked into our semiotically led design process by going a bit deeper into the phenomenological, philosophical underpinning of Peirce's semiotic theory. To the things themselves. Hi, if you've watched these videos before, you probably know by now I'm Dave Wood, a design educator and researcher, a published design author, and have worked commercially as both a freelance illustrator and graphic designer. The guy behind the theory, Charles Sanders Peirce, was a philosopher, a mathematician, and a theorist, but he wasn't a creative. Each week on this Scouse-Scot Semiosis 101 YouTube channel, I'll post at least one 10-minute explainer video on an aspect of Peirce's pragmatic semiotic theory. Each free Semiosis 101 10-minute video will use designer-centric terms instead of theoretical language so that illustrators and graphic designers can understand and follow. Each video will feature a take-home piece of applicable semiotic theory, and they do interconnect to build up your understanding of semiosis. But this channel is not a course in semiotics per se. Instead, each video is a bite-sized illustrated piece of new knowledge on sign action, or semiosis as Peirce names it. The aim of these three videos is to take Peirce's quite complex philosophical theoretical language and put it in the context of designing visual communication, whether these are illustrations, motion, branding, packaging, editorial, etc. By subscribing to this Scouse-Scot Semiosis 101 YouTube channel, you will learn how Peirce's pragmatic semiotic theory of semiosis can help to enhance and improve how you visually communicate. I have many more Peircean semiotic topics to discuss, but I'd be interested in hearing about your semiotic ideas. Add a comment below. If you like this video, check out my other semiotic videos and consider liking and sharing those videos with others. The more we creatives discuss semiotic theory, the easier its application into our creative processes will be. As a fellow creative and a published design author, I have a link in the description to my Scouse-Scot website where you can find all the Semiosis 101 videos and read background info on the blog. You can download free Semiosis 101 video transcripts and reading lists. You can buy illustrated and typographical gift ranges on my Redbubble shop. You can also buy my 2014 design book published by Bloomsbury Publishing, Interface Design, an Introduction to Visual Communication in UI Design. Over the years, I have collaborated with other design academic researchers and Peircean semioticians to develop a designer-centric explanation of Peircean's theoretical language. If you are interested in reading my semiotic Rosetta Stone academic writing, then you can visit my academia.edu link in the description. Any other books on Peircean semiotics or design I've mentioned in the videos are also listed in the description. Check them out too. Thanks for watching. Check out the other videos, like and share them with your friends, and hit the bell and subscribe buttons to be notified when next week's video is published. You can also follow Semiosis 101 on the socials for updates. It's Scouse_Scot on Instagram and Semiosis 101 on Twitter. See you all again next week for more Semiosis 101 to help illustrators and designers to enhance your visual communication skills.